So our next speaker is going to talk about Mayotte. His name is Marian, and he has been building a very nice test bed of about 200 devices, right? Yes, and sorry?
It's not ready yet.
Yes. There you go. So welcome very much, and go ahead.
First, I have a question. Who knows how a Mac works? What need I to do to go to full screen? So if I press J and K, it doesn't work. If I press the arrows, it does work. Perfect. So this will work. Yeah, thank you very much for having me here. I will talk about the Mayotte nodes, the hardware in the testbed. And in order to do so, I will first give you a little bit of background. Most of you already know what a testbed is, and for those who do not know, you don't really need. All what you need to know is that it's basically a bunch of IoT nodes that you can run real-world wireless communication experiments on, and everything needed to do so. So the infrastructure in form of software and hardware, and the experimentation methodology. And this is all you need to know what a testbed is. And the next part of the talk will focus on the hardware in detail, and I will conclude with some use cases for the Mayotte testbed, but not the usual use cases, which would be research, but the use case for us developers in Riot. Okay, this is the Mayotte node. It's actually two nodes. One is an x86 node, and this is for us basically a system that can flash Riot on the embedded node, that can control it and monitor it. It could be used for experiments as well, but this is out of scope. And the embedded node, this is the one here on top, this messy thing. And this is the one I will talk about, and this can be used to run Riot. So our main design choice was that we are not really hardware guys, so we wanted to use out of the box, off the shelf hardware that will just work. And this reduces significantly our redevelopment time, and it will just work because it's well tested and has proven in practice. As base, we are using Nucleo F767ZI, and on top of this, we are putting, so this is the Nucleo, the white one here below, and the green one is an adapter PCB, which basically is a set of jumper wires. So, and we connect on top of this breakout boards so that we end up with a modular design. So whenever we want to add a transceiver, we go for a breakout board that already works and functions, that we can that can be bought off the shelf. And basically, we connect it as kind of fancy jumper wires with this adapter PCB. Okay. So let's go to the connectivity of the board. Our design goal was that we wanted to provide multiple options for connectivity that can be used in parallel. And we want to basically tick all the boxes. So there are three relevant ISM frequency bands in Europe, and we want to have one option for all. And we have a lot of different characteristics for the communication we have in the IoT, ranging from high data rate, high power, short distance communications like Wi-Fi, to super low data rate, super low power, super long distance communication options like LoRa, and we want to tick them and everything in between, kind of. So I will take a little bit of time to explain this slide, but the following five slides will look identically to this, only with the arrows moved, and I will just rush through them. So the first connectivity option we have is Wi-Fi, and we use an ESP32 for that. And here we can see that it's in the 2.4 gigahertz band. It can provide 150 megabits per second in best case, and in the very best case, 250 meters of outdoor distance, not at that 150 megabits rate. And generally, please treat these numbers here in the communication distance as a rough guess, because it will depend a lot on the situation you use. And I think with the PCB antenna in the ESP32, you will not reach the 250 meters. Okay, then we have BLE on the same ESP32. And as I said, I will just rush through the slides. The next is the NRF 24L1 Plus, which is a custom protocol, the enhanced shockburst protocol that it sends. And some guy in the internet claimed to manage 1 kilometer of outdoor distance with the PCB antenna shown here. This will not be possible. I guess 100 meter with the PCB antenna, but we will go for another breakout module which will have a proper antenna. So maybe we would have something similar to 1 kilometer. The CC1101 is another option where we cover the 432 megahertz ISM band, and it's in the medium range of the transmission speed. Then we have the 15.4 in the 2.4 gigahertz band, also in the medium range of the transmission speed and the low range. And then lastly, the slowest option available will be LoRa, which is super low power and super long range. So more than 10 kilometer outdoors with proper equipment is no problem with that. Okay, next we have a bunch of sensors. Well, actually we have two sensors. The BME is used to measure outdoor environment stuff. It is located in the case near air vents so that we can actually measure what is happening around the node. And the SHT is located in the middle of the case so that we can also monitor the environment inside the box. We also added an external EEPROM chip so that we can store configuration and calibration data, because we do want to avoid burning this into the firmware, and we want to locate it somewhere separately from the flash so that during the flashing it does not get overwritten. So, and now the really important part and the really interesting part, at least from my point of view, is the power monitoring. So, as I said, we wanted to use unmodified off-the-shelf hardware, but we also want to monitor the power of the baseboard of the Nucleo. And the Nucleo does not offer it. And hardware modification was not really an option for us. We wanted to keep using the USB connector that is used to power, flash, and monitor the device. And we wanted also to keep all the voltage regulators internally and not touch it at all. Our solution for this was to unplug a jumper wire, which basically connects two pins. One is the 5 volt from the USB, and the other one is the 5 volt input of the board. And we put a pin header on top of that and use this to reroute the power through a shunt resistor. And using the voltage drop, measuring the voltage drop at the shunt resistor, we are able to calculate the use current. And also, we will be monitoring the bus voltage so that we can also calculate the consumed power by that. Another design goal was that we do not only want to monitor the power of the main board, but also we want to break down the power consumption by each component. That means that we want to power all the transceivers and all the breakout boards I just mentioned separately, and through this power through shunt resistors equally. And we basically added our own 3.3 voltage regulator to the PCB, used the 5 volt of the USB that we already have tapped into, and regulate this down to 3.3 volt, bypassing the shunt of the main board so that the power consumption of the other stuff does not add on the power consumption of the board. And then from the 3.3 volt that comes out of the regulator, we pass it through a shunt each to the power domains so that we can monitor the individual power domains. This is how it looks on the schematic. So basically here, that on the left is the shunt for the board. Here we have the USB 5 volt, and this is the 5 volt input of the board. And here we have the power regulator, which regulates from the USB 5 volt down to 3.3 volt. This 3.3 volt is inputted into each of the remaining shunt resistor, and the output is then the individual power domains. This is how it looks on the board. So we have 6 shunt resistors and 6 power monitoring channels. And those two guys here are the INA3221 power monitors, which will measure the voltage drop at the shunt resistors and the bus voltage so that we can actually monitor the power. And we added a capacitor to smooth the supply voltage a bit. Those are the power domains we are monitoring. So basically for all transceivers except for the ESP32, we have an individual power domain. The ESP32 is not monitored at all, and there's a reason for this. I will come to that later. And the sensors and the EEPROM, they are combined to one power domain. So we only know about the total power consumption of all sensors and the EEPROM combined. So now we have the data at the INA 3221, and we need to read them out periodically. What we could do is just use the Nucleo to do that. But the problem is then we have to do this all the time, which will reduce the sleeping cycles, which will add CPU load and basically add power consumption. And the worst thing when we are monitoring power is to actually increase power consumption by monitoring it. So we want to do this separately, and the ESP32 is used to do that instead. So the ESP32 that already provides Wi-Fi and BLE is also connected to the power monitors and acquires the data and passes this to the x86 host node. Okay, now the use cases of our MIOT nodes. One would be that it could be used to do regular, let's say each release a bunch of tests to detect regressions. And because we can monitor power, we can detect power, increases in power requirements. We can detect regressions in performance. For example, we could do all the already implemented benchmarks. We can also add network performance validation. We can, for example, measure the round trip time for all of the six connectivity options we have. We could measure the throughput. We could also measure the reliability of the network stack, especially in high load scenarios. And so on. And another really nice thing that it could be used for is doing development and review, because basically most of the time we have to optimize on a lot of stuff, which basically conflicts. So those are the six most important things we optimize our code for that came to my mind. Maybe there are more. And there are some problems with it. The first is that some of them have good numbers, we can measure them and quantify them, but for example, there is little way to quantify code complexity and maintainability, or for example, functionality and security is hard to give numbers for that. This is something we cannot solve with the MIOT testbed, and there's also another problem that on some of this scales, it's hard to acquire data. Especially power consumption is something where it's difficult to get in detail data with individual components, with a lot of experiment repetitions done on a lot of nodes. And this is something that we will be able to do when we have the MIOT testbed. And this will give us better insight. So for example, when I would get a pull request that would reduce the ROM size by 100 byte, and on the same side would triple the power consumption, I would say this is a poor trade-off. But if I would get the same PR to review, and I know it reduces 100 byte ROM size, and I have no idea what the impact on the power consumption is, I would likely accept that. So it's extremely valuable to actually know what is the impact on all of these metrics. And if we have this, we can get to better trade-offs. And this is where I think the testbed can help. Okay. The testbed, as I said, we are currently developing it. I have no ETA. It will not be finished this year. But once it's finished, we will drop an email and feel invited to use it. Thank you.
All right. So time for questions.
So can you contrast the ESP complexity and abilities of the ESP32 compared to the processor that you actually are testing? And it just seems a bit odd to me. Why don't you just use two of the ones that you are testing with, for instance?
Well, because of support in the wire, the STM32 platform is really well supported, and we really do not want to have a pain with the test bed. So I just went with
that. But you're not measuring the power of the Wi-Fi.
Why are we not measuring the power of the Wi-Fi?
But you're not measuring that.
Yeah, exactly, because I do not want to have any dependency on the monitoring of the power consumption and the power consumption. We could add a second of that, but that would increase cost and complexity. We could consider and calculate. Yeah, but basically the idea was that it's a trade-off. We would have to buy a second board, and I think there is not so much value because Wi-Fi is high power anyway, and if I really care about power consumption, I'm just not using Wi-Fi.
Okay, I have actually two questions. The first one is, when the testbed opens, will it be open for anyone, also for commercial users?
That's a good question. maybe, okay. Likely, but I cannot decide on that.
Okay. Second question.
I think it also depends on your use case. If you, for example, say you have an interesting experiment and you want to find out how many bitcoins you can mine with 266 node, likely the answer will be no.
No, I meant more in the sense like doing testing for a commercial product using wireless technologies. But anyway, just maybe we can
just discuss it.
Second question about the power consumption measurement. Do you already have some numbers or at least some feeling about the accuracy and dynamics of the solution?
The driver for the INR3221 is just in development, so we cannot give you any only the ones from the data sheet, and I do not trust data sheets.
All right, thank you again. And now we have Ghetto.